All right. Let's see, I think there's a clicker over here somewhere. Quick question. For how many folks, quick show of hands, how many folks is your first Klaviyo in-person event? Klaviyo London 2023. Awesome. All right, another show of hands. For how many folks is how many folks were here Klaviyo London 2022? Excellent. All right, now I'll stretch a little bit. How many folks came to, I think we had Klaviyo London, but Klaviyo Boston in 2019 before the pandemic? All right, a couple of hands. Awesome. So when I think about a company, I think all great companies are made up of two things. They're great products and they're great people. And when we talk about people, that doesn't just mean employees. It also means the community that surrounds it. And so Klaviyo's community, I'm always humbled by this, is now over 100,000 businesses and brands, more than 5,000 agencies, partners. It's not on this slide, but over 200 software companies and distributed all over the world. And it's not just that we've grown a great community, a great set of people, but we're really successful. Oh, hang on. $37 billion in own revenue last year, but we're in London, so we'll do it in pounds. £29 billion pounds of revenue generated by you all through Klaviyo. This is a number, we refer to this not as, this isn't the revenue of your of all of our businesses added up, but it's specifically the portion that we're driving through direct relationships with our customers. This is something I obsess over. It's my morning routine is wake up, go for a run, and then we check our dashboard. And the reason is, because when we started Klaviyo, I believe that ad networks, marketplaces, those weren't the long-term bet. The long-term bet was folks like us who are creating and building. We were going to go straight to consumers, straight to our customers, and get to own that relationship. And so internally, you know, we'd set these goals, and people used to think I was kind of crazy about it. We'd say, hey, yo, let's look at how large Amazon's marketplace is, or eBay, or let's estimate how much in sales we think is driven through Google or Facebook. And let's set a goal of someday Klaviyo is going to be even bigger than that. And so we're making awesome progress on that. And the reason this matters is because at Klaviyo, my life's mission, what I get excited about, is helping people who love creating, not just TikTok videos, but products, services, sharing a piece of yourself with the world. I love helping folks like that be more successful, to take ownership of their success. And when we talk about ownership, I mean that in two ways. The first is I want people to be independent, successful, independent of others. You shouldn't have to need a dependency on a third party to get distribution. You should be able to get to the people who would love what you've created all on your own. So there's independence. And then the second part is about giving you control so that we give you the skills. A lot of us, we're busy, things move quickly. How can software technology help us do more? Take that creative spark, those ideas we have, that we infuse into our products, into our marketing, and share it with the world. So what I'm going to talk about today is two things. The first, I want to talk a little bit about where I see software going and how it's going to help us as creators build bigger and better companies, products, delight more customers. And then two, we're going to talk about some cool new product stuff that we've released recently and some things that we're sharing for the first time here today. So we're all here to create. I want to go back in time a little bit. I think we are on the, we are beginning a new era of software. In my lifetime, I've seen two eras that preceded this, and one that I think is just starting up. So I want to talk a little bit about each of those and how that's going to make our lives as folks who create and build hopefully better. So the first era of software, I think, those of us to know, it was the PC era. When I was 9 or 10 years old, I used to have to write book reports in grade school. How many folks had to write book reports, essays, 5-paragraph essay back in grade school? And my pattern was I would write my essay in on lined sheet of paper with pencil, because I knew there was going to be some erasing. I would turn in that assignment to my mom, and she would edit it. And I prayed that the edits were, well, you picked the wrong word here, so you only have to erase one little piece. Because inevitably she'd say, hey, Andrew, this is kind of good, but you're actually missing a whole sentence or a paragraph. And so this picture here on the left, how many folks remember having to write essays and you use that character on our keyboard that nobody really uses anymore, that caret key to insert a whole new set of, a whole bunch of sentences, new language. And I dreaded this process. Inevitably, if it got too messy, you should say, hey, you just have to rewrite the whole thing. I remember when we got our first computer, and it came with word processing. And at the time, I wasn't very good at typing. I said, man, why am I going to invest all this time to type this thing up? Like, this is going to stink. But the magic of being able to put my words into a digital program, print it out, then have my editor-in-chief go to town on it, and then know that I could just bring it back to a computer and instantly make these edits, that changed the game. And so I think a lot of us have had that experience, if you're as old as I am, of going from paper and pencil to, hey, now I have software that will encode my thinking and my thoughts. So that's era number one. Then number two, we get the internet, and I'll include, mobile with this. When I went to university, I asked my parents for one thing. There's one thing I really wanted. I said, I'm going to really need this for college. This is early 2000s. And that one thing was, I said, Mom, Dad, I want you to buy me an encyclopedia. Now, this wasn't the old school encyclopedia that was at my grandma's house, where it's like all the books, A to Z. I said, no, I want Microsoft Encarta. I want the stuff that comes on a CD, and I'm going to install it on my computer, and I'm going to use that when I go to school to look stuff up. Well, I can tell you, I never used that encyclopedia. I'm a little embarrassed to say this as somebody who fancies themselves as a technologist. I never touched that. It was Google from there on out. And so I think the same thing has happened. You think about that. We went from software on CDs. It was hard to update. It was hard to collaborate with others. None of us use, installed Microsoft Word. Now we all either use a version that's in the browser. Or if it's a desktop app, it syncs automatically. So it's available from all of our devices. We can share it with other people. We can collaborate on it. So those first two eras, in each case, there was a way of working that we all got used to. Then the software came along. At first, it was just the first version of software on our desktops. But then with the internet, all of that software got rewritten. And I share this because I think we're at the point now where there's another wave coming, where all of the technology we use, all the software that we rely on, is going to get upgraded, improved, and we should expect the companies that build that software to adapt and level up. And so I call this third era of software intelligent software. And you could say that's a riff off in AI, artificial intelligence. And I think maybe a good analogy to draw here is I remember when I had a flip phone, before we had smartphones. We never really called them dumb phones, but I think we all look back, and that's kind of what it felt like. I remember how magical it felt when I had a flip phone, and you could look up something like a sports score or the weather. And then when the iPhone came out, and all of a sudden there were things like, I remember driving around with a friend just to watch the little blue dot on an iPhone track the roads that we were driving on. And so all of a sudden, what felt like amazing became table stakes. You can browse the internet. You can connect. You know, you can video chat with friends and family. Any business application, all of a sudden, it's available in our pocket. I think the software we use is about to undergo a similar transition. And a similar transition on three dimensions. First, we're going to expect the software that we use to know who we are, to know us intimately. There's an analogy Steve Jobs makes about software, really about computing in general. He said, hey, a computer is like a bicycle for the mind. And the bicycle analogy is meant to show that software is really, computers are there just to make us more productive. The way we can all walk around, but a bicycle helps us get from point A to B more quickly. I think what's happening now is we're going to expect the software that we use to know who we are and be tailor fit to what we want to accomplish. So I think you'd expect with intelligent software, it's going to know who we are, know who our customers are, it's going to know our goals, and then finally, it's going to do the thinking for us. It's going to help us strategize on how best to achieve an outcome. So rather than the, admittedly, what's going to feel like kind of dumb applications of today, where we as the users have to know how to use them, what our objective is, and how to map from the actions we can take inside of software to that ultimate outcome, all of a sudden the software is going to do that for us. And to do that, with Klaviyo, I want to give you a little peek into how we think about that. Right, so we've got the old way, web browsers, collaborative editing, the new way, hey, I don't even want to do the writing, just tell me what the answer is. Or let me become the editor-in-chief. And the way we're going to go about this at Klaviyo, the problem that exists today with the software that we've built, the reason it's inadequate, is that it doesn't really know much about us. That's the first thing we have to solve. One of my beliefs about technology is that its representation of people, of each of us, either as users of software or as the objects that software is going to interact with, it's too simplistic. I refer to this at Klaviyo as we think about people as just a set of facts. My name is Andrew. I work at a company called Klaviyo. I live in the United States. And I have a hobby called running. That's not enough detail about me to build a great experience. You're missing subtleties where it's, hey, when I get off the plane, the first thing I do in London is go for a run through Burgess Park. Or that before I go back to the States, I'm in big trouble with my two kids if I don't bring back at least one or two magnets for the fridge. It's those details, not just facts, but the actions we take that really define us. And so the problem with the software of today is it has this very simple representation of each of us. And then if you have a simplistic representation of each of us, all we can build are very basic, dumb applications that result in, admittedly, not good enough experiences. And so at Klaviyo, what we obsess over is how do we make humans, how do we model people more authentically? How do we store that information and then put it to work? So our view of the future is we are increasing the visibility you have into who you are as a user, but then each of your end customers and consumers, and then we're going to put that to work with more intelligent applications that can leverage that data. They know who you are, they know what you're trying to achieve, they can then help you optimize, help you figure out what the right path is, help you run your experiments, and that in turn is going to lead to a wave of intelligent experiences. So when we think about product development at Klaviyo, we really focus on two parts. One, what's in the box down below here, which is how do we give each of you as a business, as developers, as partners, as agencies, the infrastructure so you can accurately represent people the way they truly are. And then on top of that, You may build the applications. How can we build a set of applications that is actually, that are actually intelligent? And so in the future, we think about a Klaviyo where, let's say I'm designing a campaign for the holidays. I'm no longer picking a subject line, designing content, deciding who this goes to. Instead, I'm giving the software a goal, and then I become the editor-in-chief. And I'm auditing that and improving it. And then hopefully, eventually, that software can take do more of the work for me. So this is what we're up to. Now, I want to share a couple of improvements we've made to kind of further us on this journey, both on the how we think about representing people as their whole selves, and then also some of the work we've done to take some of the software that we built, some of the applications we built around marketing, and make those smarter, more intelligent too. All right, so first, on the data side, how do we represent people more accurately? A few weeks ago, really excited to announce, we launched a whole suite of new integrations around wellness. So with MindBody, Boulevard, and Zenoti. And the reason we did this is because we realized, hey, as a lot of us are retailers, but increasingly businesses, they're not just simply retail or a service business. We're becoming more hybrid. I'll give you an example. I was talking with a great entrepreneur in New York last week. And she had started a business for ear piercing. And it was ear piercing for adults. She said, hey, before we started our company, if you wanted to go get your ears pierced, you went to a tattoo parlor. It wasn't a great experience. So we wanted to develop a new concept. What do adults do when they want to get their ears pierced? Well, there's a retail component to that. They sell, you know, earrings and studs. But there was also a service component. People had to book an appointment. You had to show up on time. There was a relationship ongoing. And she said, hey, how is that going to work with Klaviyo? So Klaviyo for wellness is a larger push for us of how do we think about businesses more holistically. So rather than a business just purely being retail and products, what if it includes services? What if a business isn't just online or offline? How do we think about that in a hybrid world? So with wellness, what we've done is we've taken everything that you love about Klaviyo for commerce and just applied it to a new category. So my wife, Liz, is big into yoga. So when she joined a new studio near our house, you know, the experience was she would go to the studio, sign up for a class, and then there, frankly, when she started, there wasn't much of a digital experience. With Klaviyo now, we have the opportunity for those studios to say, hey, when somebody signs up, we can entice them to join, maybe give them the first three classes, or maybe as we learned earlier today, maybe it's the buy three, get the fourth class free. We can then remind folks when classes are coming or when they have appointments and bookings, the same way that we think about with retail. So instead of thinking about the purchase and then think about what happens after the fact, we can think about what happens before an event in a customer's life cycle. We can then encourage folks to take that free trial. My wife, Liz, she tries it out, loves the instructor. How can we convert that to a membership? And then inevitably, like what happens with us over the summer months, we get busy with kids and camps and things like that. If we lapse and then we come back to the fall, we can remind folks that, hey, we still exist and come back to return. So with Klaviyo for Wellness, you could take that as our first step towards, as you think about your business, if it's primarily retail today, we think about a future where I think more businesses are going to be a mix of retail services online and offline. And how do we make Klaviyo a great fit so you can capture all of the information about a person, not just a subset of it. So that's one thing that we're working on, adding more data to Klaviyo. Also, we talk about understanding the full person. The other thing that really matters is, can I measure the outcomes that I define my business by? For a lot of you, we built this concept of owned revenue, revenue you're generating directly from your customers, straight into Klaviyo's product. Now, I remember talking with a lot of you, and you said, that's great that it's on the Klaviyo dashboard when I log in, but I'm frustrated. Because if I ever want to look at historical trends, a lot of us like to compare things. Hey, where were we relative to last year, or last month, or last quarter? Really difficult to do. So at Klaviyo, in the last few weeks, we've launched a new dashboard that allows you to visualize your performance over the last year and compare it with any periods you want. So if you ran if you introduced a new product and you want to see the performance before and after, you can run that comparison. As we all prepare for the holidays this year, if you want to compare how your business is growing, how your customers are interacting with your brand in the months leading up to the holidays, you can run those same comparisons. And we want to make that possible all within Klaviyo. So I'm really excited about the work that we've done here. I'll also add, I'm excited, we're doing a lot of work on attribution becomes so important for a product like ours. You have to believe directionally that the results that Klaviyo is showing you are right. If you pick a goal and we help you measure it, we then want to help you optimize and define a strategy to go after that target. Part of that for us is feeling like we can be good stewards. We can help you understand where you're succeeding and where you're not, so we can tell you where to double down and maybe which experiments are best to sunset. So that's some work we're doing around data and reporting. Now on to the making more applications intelligent. We started Klaviyo with email because we asked you all, what is the most ubiquitous medium that balances openness? Email is an open protocol. Anybody can send anybody else in the world an email. We added SMS and text messaging. After that, as more consumers shift to wanting to have a more intimate relationship with the businesses that they love. And now finally, there's one more channel, direct-to-consumer channel, own channel, that I'm excited that we've added support for. A few years ago, we built in support to Klaviyo for folks that have iOS applications they distribute through Apple. And in the last month, we've added the functionality that now if you also have an application for Android in the Google ecosystem, you can also message folks through that. Our goal on the messaging side is to meet customers where they want to be met. So where your end consumers, if they have a preference, either that they've shared with you directly or you can intuit, we're going to help you collect that information and then intelligently decide what channels matter with all the same trimmings that you'd expect when Klaviyo goes after a channel. So starting today, I'm very excited that if you are a business that not only does email, not only collects phone numbers, but if you also have a mobile application or that's on your roadmap, you can now support all of that communication through Klaviyo in one place. And as we think about adding new channels, we always think about the things that you know and love about Klaviyo. You expect us to be really easy to use, have outstanding design, great deliverability, and great reporting, great metrics so you can understand what happened. So I'm really excited about what we've done with mobile and push. All right, and I have one more announcement for today. The era of intelligent software, intelligent applications is beginning. And you know Klaviyo for marketing automation across all of these different channels. Today we're adding a new product that we're going to take and move from that simple, basic, not so intelligent category and move it into the intelligent category. And that product is reviews. So I want to give you a little bit of a tour of Klaviyo for reviews and explain, one, what we think to be standard for what a reviews, you know, software should do, and then how we're leveling it up to help it match your expectations, help make it do more of the work for you. All right, so reviews. Let's say you're a skincare brand. If anybody's ever bought or used skincare products, you know there's a lot of personal taste, a lot of personal fit that goes into that. So one of the things we believe in at Klaviyo is you need to learn from your customers, have this data not only intuitively from them, from what they buy or return, but also you should actively ask them questions and understand what they love. So with reviews, you think about that. Okay, so I bought something from our skincare line here. You can do basic star ratings, and then you can collect those either over email, text messaging, or in the near future, also over mobile. And so we've got a great interface that makes this really easy to do. So that's pretty much table stakes when we think about collecting user, customer feedback, surveying reviews. Then in addition to that, we've built a great UI that will blend in with your website, with your brand. So you can take that same aesthetic and instantly show off that social proof that says, hey, here are the products that our customers love most, and here's what they love about them. All right, so all that's kind of what we expect when we collect user feedback, when we collect reviews. I want to tell you how we've made that more intelligent. In my way of analogy, I'll tell you, like when I think about reviews, I think about in feedback, it's about how I take that data and then action it in the future. I've got two little kids, a 3-year-old and a 5-year-old, and every Sunday we go on a family adventure. Mom and dad and the two kids hop in the car, and we pick some park or playground or some activity, and we drive out and we go spend an hour there, have some lunch, and then come home. All right, so my kids, if anybody has young kids, they're not afraid of giving feedback. Hey, this playground, not enough swings. I really like the parks that have ducks to feed. Hey, that slide over there, it's metal and it gets too hot when it's sunny out. So we're constantly collecting feedback as parents. And yes, I'm sharing that with other parents that we know so they can use that with their kids. But intuitively, what I'm doing is we're thinking about that and then making decisions about where we go next, what experience experience we're going to deliver for our kids the next Sunday. Because I don't really want to sit in the car and hear a lot about whatever. There weren't enough slides, enough swings. So when we think about the same thing applied to our reviews product, what we've done is we've taken all the data that you collect with a review and made it, one, customizable. So when you ask for feedback, you're actually asking for feedback about that product, but you're also asking that customer about their preferences. What other questions? You're weaving that into the user experience. And then on top of that, we're making that instantly accessible inside of Klaviyo so you can put that to work in other applications. So in this case, the data you collect in reviews is instantly accessible for marketing and messaging. So in this case, if somebody shares with us, hey, what their preferred skin type is, whether they're I have dry skin or it's kind of oily, now I can instantly inside of Klaviyo have all of that data. It's all structured and normalized and cleaned up for us. I can build segments. And then I can immediately build flows and campaigns off of that. And now all of a sudden, the reviews that I'm collecting, that data is making my marketing smarter. In fact, I can even use that same data to customize the questions I ask the next time somebody leaves me a review. This is step one of what I believe is the important part of how we're going to move from the applications of today to intelligent applications that know who we are, know who our customers are, know the goals that we're after, and can help us connect the dots. Awesome. So to round out this talk, I want to do two things. One, I want to invite the team that built reviews up on stage. We've flew them in all the way from the States over into London. So Hanson and Jeff, the two lead product and engineering. And Jess in product marketing. All right. So we've got a few minutes left. What we've done is we've created a QR code here. And we're gonna a little bit of audience participation here. I'm gonna give you a chance to give some feedback about this talk. So let's say two things. One, like my kids, you can be direct. That's okay. We're all open to feedback. But let's keep it just like my kids. Let's keep it PG. So we're gonna collect some feedback here. We were gonna try to rig this up so you could see the results live inside of our software. But instead, Jeff and Hansen and Jess, they've said, well, actually, we're gonna show you the results downstairs. So if you're interested in seeing what our reviews product looks like in action, there's a booth downstairs that folks can go check out right after this talk. Okay? Awesome. So I'll leave this up here for another minute. I'll close with this. If there's two things today that I'd like you to take away, companies are products and people. And by people, not just employees, we think about community. What I love about the Klaviyo community is we are all creators. All of us have that creative spark, and we've somehow woven our way through school and through life and managed to not just fit in, but we have something that we, whether it's a product or a service, we have something we want to share with the world, and we're not afraid to put it out there. The world needs more creators. That's the reason Ed and I started Klaviyo. I remember my grandma, when she got her first smartphone, and I remember her telling me stories about when she was a kid, you know, that, you know, forget about smartphones and video chat and all this kind of stuff. The best that she had was black and white TVs had just come out. How many folks remember the TVs that had bunny ears and you'd turn a dial? I think about her life and how much the technology, the products, the services that existed when she was a kid to where she is now, how much those evolved, how far we've come. But that didn't happen by dumb luck. That's because somebody, many of us, millions of us, chose to be creators, chose to create. And it wasn't that all of our creations were great, but that's collectively how we made life better for ourselves and for the rest of the world. At Klaviyo, that's our passion. We need more creators, and so we're here to help you. And the last thing I'll say is, I believe that the software that we use needs to get better to help more of us create more efficiently. I want to see a lot of cool stuff in my lifetime. And as part of that, it means the tools that we use need to get better. We have a great community of a lot of smart, accomplished folks. And you should expect from us and from others that we're moving from an era of simple software to intelligent software that will take our ideas and help us make them more successful. So with that, thank you very much for coming today. We've got a lot more in store. Great to see you all. Cheers.